thank you for tuning in to the third installment of our Pain and Suffering series. This will be the last class in that mini-series. This is called Why Do Good People Suffer? Ready? All right. So we did, if you remember, we did three classes, right? Kabbalah the Narcissist, and another class about like the suffering of Eov. The title wasn't so clear. It was about suffering, right? And kind of a transition class from the Kabbalah and the Narcissist, and this class materialized as the end. This is a discourse on Eov. Why? There's a lot of stuff going on today, as you can tell by the news. ISIS is chopping heads off. There's a lot of stuff, right? So, somebody very close to the Noahide gear world committed suicide. Right? Names don't need to be said, but it happened. You know, my personal story, right? And my personal family are moments of that genre, right? So it touches close to home. And there's a lot of din in the world. Suffice it to say, my personal ambition has been to understand and uncover what is suicide, right? From, again, personal brushes up and family members and friends, and I seem to be the center of that kind of controversy or chaos, just a different point, mazel moments in my life. So that said, it's been a family inion to try to uncover, and you know, what is it? Anybody that goes through suicide is going to find themselves asking very quickly, what is it? Why? I mean, it's like the biggest waste in the world. Here's a person filled with life and then happiness, smile, then all of a sudden gone. Everybody starts blaming and pointing fingers. It's horrible. No one knows what it is. It's a tremendous evil. The person wasn't, you know, you didn't see them as evil. Then when they're gone, it's chaos. So again, you know, my father is Nifter from the time I'm three months old. So I'm trying to figure out my whole life. That's all I know, is that black cloud. What is this? And then, you know, with Perry, right? Gone. And people close by. So it's pertinent in my life to find out what it is. And I attract those kind of souls of either, you know, people contemplating or knowing someone, right? All the as you say, the Rachmanis cases, right? That's in a nice way. We're all trying to kind of, you know, uncover these kind of mysteries of life. So as the most recent affairs take place, I'm making a push because I want to understand. And a friend chimes in on Skype. And I made an Eov joke. Because when you get involved with Eov, you find yourself making Eov jokes. Not jokes, but, you know, jabs. Like, you know, do you suffer like Eov? Now, just to give you a bit of context, when the last episode attacked my personal family, right, you know what I'm talking about, my grieving process was helped by a very close friend of mine. And we had a very intense chavrusa, extremely intense. And it turned out that it was focusing on Eov. Now, before we even touch this, we have to understand Eov. So the biggest gem I got from that chavrusa was Eov is like an impenetrable fortress. What opens up Eov, and my friend, you know, he's the one that really got me to see this, without giving, you know, names and experiences and mice, and what he taught me was, and I was a clef for it for my own personal grieving, right? So and that was the most enlightening time of my life, you know. So, you know, the grieving and life and, you know, getting the kids and then Eov and the intensity and all these things. The bottom line is, when you are miscavin into Eov, when you superimpose on Eov whatever mishigas you want to put on him, you know, Eov is going through narcissism, right? Narcissism in Kabbalah class, right? Eov is going through identity crisis. Eov is going through the ego. Whatever you put on Eov, and you start from page one to page, you know, end of the book, if you can maintain your head, hold cup, you will see a consistent flavor of Eov. And then Eliphaz and the three friends and the fourth friend, Eliu, right? It all come to life. If I tell you ego is Eo's plight, then you'll realize, so Eliphaz is coming, right? It makes sense. That's the godliness of Eo. It just comes to life. Whatever Mishigas you put on him, he's taking your Mishigas. That's the divinity of Eov. He is the ultimate sufferer. And so there's always a challenge. The more we suffer, then you superimpose it on Eov and you learn from Eov. So one would say it's a sadistic kind of learning, right? You're bringing it on yourself because you're addicted to Eov's suffering. Anybody that gets into Eov has this kind of relationship with Eov. Right? It's kind of like this relationship you get into and you can't get out. Now, the point being is that's Eov. That was taught to me and that's been my personal association with Eov. Now, I made my comment to my friend. And I said, you know, you don't suffer like Eov. And he says, Rabbi Katz, I tend to agree with our discussions. This one you're wrong. Eov was not the master sufferer. And, he knew he was going to get a rise at me. And I'm saying, okay, no, why? He said something to me, it was really weird. He said, Yitzchak Avinu is the sufferer, and he is in Eov. Now, I've seen a lot of Perushim on Eov. And just so you know, this book I recommend to everybody. Right? It's the Malbim translated on Eov. I don't hold by English books, you know that. This one was done right. Honest translation, great print, great layout. This is godless. This is Chacham. You know, again, I don't like English. But the funny thing is Eov is one of the hardest books to crack in Hebrew. So this is a real Metziah. This is a real Pella. That it's the Dafka where you want it to be hard in the Hebrew. And he opens it up. So it's really this whole series and class is something nice for that reason. So then he brings the Perushim and I'm into it. It's a hobby of mine at this point, Eov. Now, he says Yitzchak is in here, but he doesn't remember where. And all he can remember is Avraham got the situation of getting old. You remember this Pindrish? He gets old. Avraham got old. Yeah. Right? And then Yitzchak took on suffering, and Yaakov took on sickness. So they had to sit at Yaakov's deathbed. Right? And then Avraham got old by the time of Yitzchak. And Yitzchak with Yekeda took on suffering. So that's the butting of heads. You have Eov, who's the master of suffering, and Yitzchak suffers. Now remember where my headspace is. I'm dealing with suicide, and why is it? What is it? What's the Torah of it? Why is it in the world? Which is a nice way of saying, why do good people suffer? Anytime someone commits suicide, what do you say? They never had a chance, they were a good person, they had a rough lot in life. Right? You have all these tie-ins on why they shouldn't have died. And then all the balagan starts. So Yitzchak, you can say, gave himself over to the knife too. Right? He offered himself up on the Mizbeach, on the Akedah. He wasn't fighting it. He went for it. Right? We say he had the greater defiance sometimes than Avraham because he went to the knife. Avraham was the one who didn't want to do it necessarily. And you say, that's the gevurah of Yitzchak. Well, maybe that's the lunacy of Yitzchak. I mean, why is he doing this? I mean, why is he going for the knife? Yeah, so it's a bit of a contradiction when you think about it, psychologically. So when I look at the Perushim, I type in Yitzchak, Yitzchak Avinu, I forget what it was, and Eov, and I'm trying to find, where's Yitzchak? First I thought it was Eliphaz. Because again, why? Because Eliphaz is what the grandson of Yitzchak, right? And then before she would say, it was a weird word in Hebrew, I forget, I didn't bother looking it up because I saw that it wasn't exactly the thing, but I saw that he was related to Eliphaz. But I knew that, again, that was not deep shot. So I looked further. It turns out Rabbi Akiva has a machlekes in the Gemara somewhere. I forget where. I think it's Sanhedrin. I'm not sure. Or Fusekta. But the Chazal say Elihu, the fourth friend of Eov, is Yitzchak Avinu. Big Kiddush, isn't it? Now, what's even the bigger Kiddush? We know that in the Chumash, Yitzchak has like, what, two lines? The Vavda Avos, we don't know Yitzchak at all. And then you go to Masechta Shabbos and you hear, Yitzchak is the father of Israel. He battled it out with God and said, God, you know, I'm their father. You know, they're the half their life, they're sleeping, and third of their life, right? And we say, yes, you're our father, Yitzchak. The Rizal was an aspect of Mashiach ben Yosef. You like Mashiach ben Yosef, right?
Yeah.
And so the Rizal and Shargul Golem learns that he's connected to Mashiach ben Yosef because his name is Yitzchak. They bring a pasuk about what is in Hebrew, but the English is a time the moed of Yerushalayim, Sion is revealed, like the mem turns to a yud, which for Yitzchak, whatever it is. So it's Rosh Hatevis Yitzchak. And then if you play around with the words, the letters another way, the Tochatevis, I think, is spelled Chaim, which is the son of Rav Chaim Vital. Or Chaim Vital, Chaim Vital, Chaim. And his son found it. He's the one who wrote it. So the point is that the Rizal's Torah was Mashiach ben Yosef Dick, and then they found it centralized by 208 Yitzchak. Now, why 208? That's the Gematria Pinchas. So then when you go in again, into the Torah of the Rizal, Parshas Pinchas, the whole story with Pinchas standing up with the spear, Pinchas is Gematria 208, same as Yitzchak, and the Rizal says that Pinchas is related to Mashiach ben David and Mashiach ben Yosef, based on the letters of his name, Pei Nun Yud, which is the left, which is Yosef, the Gevuras, the five final letters of Menatzbach, Pei Nun, and the right is Ches Samech, Gematria Chaim, associated with Mashiach ben David, see the Arizal in Parshas Pinchas for those that are interested. Okay, therefore, we have Yitzchak coming on the scene, he's in Eov, he is Elihu. Right, we don't really need to read the whole book of Eov to understand this shir. The point is, we can get you caught up in one sentence. Eov has a rough time with life and with God, and he has all these answers he's coming up with, justifying, rationalizing why is God doing it. And the three friends are basically giving answers that are not acceptable. No one's happy. No one's. What I will call it is that they're giving him the party line. And Eov, and this is a bold statement, but as we say, we can upload our Nourishkeit on Eov. That's the point of Eov. I want to say Eov, as the sufferer, the ultimate sufferer, can't experience suicidal thoughts. He's dealing with suicide. I'm not saying he's going to go and do whatever, but when it gets rough, and God takes away your stuff, and boils, and all that Eov goes through, the thought probably crossed his mind. You know, wouldn't it be better if I'm just out of here and boop, gone? And but then, see, the chiddush is, even if you want to say, you know, he was too righteous for that, right? But his friends are there at the right time. And you get the right storm, the right chemistry, maybe they took up the topic. Maybe Eo's friend just committed suicide. He said, hey, let me do it too. You don't know the story. You don't know his mishigas, which is another level of the secret of Eo. Eov is, you don't know his mishigas. And you're trying to tell him about his mishigas when you don't even know. So you don't know what led him to this. You blame the Satan, but you don't know what really is going on with Eov. Point being, he's in a rough spot. Let's just say he's entertaining the thought, the ultimate evil thought, and they're giving him party line. Well, can't do that. He says, why? Life is horrible. Because Hashem doesn't work that way. And he's supposed to say, wow, Hashem doesn't work that way. You know, they're giving him the party line. Now, I'm not saying also that I'm so against that. I mean, in terms of like, you know, accusation on Eliphaz, how could you give the party line? Because Judaism is filled with party line, okay? Love or hate, sometimes party line just works. Because sometimes cliche actually has great meaning. Sometimes it just takes time. And you say, wow, he's right. Sometimes it does take time. Sometimes you need to be told, Hashem has funny ways. You say, yeah, it's right. Sometimes Hashem does do, you know. So you can't discount the party line. But sometimes it's inappropriate to give the party line. That's the whole book of Eov. Now, Elihu's going to come up. I like this. Now, before we start, get this gematria, right? You know, I like to give a bit of a smachta before I come in. Eliyu ben Barachel. Now, you're going to probably say, you pronounced it wrong. What's funny, let's get the nekudot to satisfy the ears of people that had a crusade, the mispronunciation of the nekudot. Eliyu ben Barachel. There, I said it right. The gematria of that name, Eliyu's full name, 358. You know what the 358 is? Mashiach. Also Nachash. Right? And that can be a whole story of Eov and right, how Mashiach offsets the Nachash, whatever. Here we go. The introduction to Elihu. Elihu is, remember, this is Yitzchak, and he has no portion of the Torah compared to Avraham and Yaakov. And it's like now we find the missing Masechta of Yitzchak. I mean, how awesome is that? Out of nowhere, we have Yitzchak talking to Eov about the Akedah. I mean, that's like finding a rare Rembrandt, isn't it? I mean, like in a storehouse somewhere. We thought we were done with Yitzchak for how many thousands of years, and here we go, a whole new learning of Yitzchak. I think it's quite awesome. So again, I'm going to follow up into the commentary that I brought down, the prelude to the commentary. And he's going to say that there's two kinds of party line. I think Judaism mirrors this very well. Those that learn the Torah like a parrot, they don't think about what it's saying, and I'm not even discrediting bad learning, I'm saying this is really bad. You know, those that literally don't know what they're saying. So that's the one answer. Just saying things based on a text that you have no idea what, you know, that's an eye for an eye. Well, anybody in Torah knows that is the dumbest thing in the world you can say. Why? Eye for an eye is kesef. Right? One letter up or down, whatever it is, right? Turns into a word for money. So everyone says in the world, it's not literally you poke his eye out, it's you restore money. So if you go around saying, well, you know, you deserve it, it's an eye for an eye, you are an idiot. It's not, that is not shot on any level. Right? And then the other way is to understand based on your view, your opinion. Right? So, you know, this guy says an eye for an eye. And the other guy says, I don't even hold to that verse. Right? I've seen guys go out and he's got his own view of the world. So Elihu is here to say, both of you guys, all three of you guys doing this kind of thinking, is wrong. Wrong. Don't give the party line by your thoughts, your own little avodah zarah. And don't give it on a perversion of the text. Your lack of learning well and your lack of perception. So that's Elihu. And Elihu's going to come in. And here we go. We're in chapter 32. Okay, I'm literally going to go through the pages. So this is going to be rapid fire in conjunction with my notes. Ready? Elihu comes in. And he is going to address the situation with Eov and his friends. Ready for rapid fire? Now this is profound. This is very profound. Elihu is in the presence of the three guys. They're all older than him. Listen to, but remember, the secret to Eov is you don't know what he's talking about because you never thought to superimpose. But now that we brought us inside, right? Eov's going through hell. It's suicidal. The friends are giving the party line. We built up the stage. We're not just going in a random text. When you go to random, you don't get it. You don't have any kind of hapdama or momentum. It doesn't do anything. But now that we know, now that we have a running start, listen to how profound this is. Remember, Eov is over there going through what he's going through. Now, this is Yitzchak. This is Yitzchak. Al Pidrosh. If it's shot, all the better. But it just works. Indeed, I am younger than all of you in years, and you are venerable. For that reason, I humbled myself, and I was afraid to express my ideas to you. I said to myself, it takes many days of cumulative experience to speak out, and only the experience of years imparts wisdom. However, wisdom is a spiritual force within humankind. And the Spirit of the Almighty inspires them. You know what the word for Spirit of the Almighty is? This is where the Hebrew comes in great. Get this. The word for that, Nishmat Shaddai. How incredible is that? Where have you heard such a word? Nishmat Shaddai. What is the Chabad talks about this and the Gra talks about it? How do you say Tikkun Olam in Hebrew? In the real Hebrew? Tikkun Olam Malchus Shaddai. Tikkun, the world of the kingdom of Shaddai. And anyone that wears tefillin knows, this is the name associated with tefillin. And so where's the knot go? The knot of the tefillin goes in the knot of your head, right? So the idea is that knot. Everyone thinks the box with the two shins, you know, kind of like an Avodah Zaradik third eye, and right? That's what we think. A lot of people think that. You know, there's something here. And there is an Indian of the Metzach in Kabbalah. But when have you ever heard people darshan here? That's the Kiddush. He says that's the place of the psyche. Like, that's the place of this part of God that's with you, and you're a walking flesh and blood, and yet you have the knot of tefillin where you have God consciousness, which I think it's a pasuk. It says that the Torah of God is in your mouth when you wear tefillin. I forget if it's a chazal or if it's a pasuk. I think it's a pasuk. But the idea is that knot is really where heaven and earth collide. Nishmat Shaddai. That's the spot. It is not the masses who become wise. So the party liners, they're not wise. Nor the elderly who understand justice. So again, the party liners who know it all because of tenure, he says, no, you also don't inherit the truth. Therefore, I say, listen to me, and I too can reveal my ideas. Behold, I have been patiently attentive to all that you have to say and listened to your overall analysis. I waited until you had completely analyzed the meaning of your words. I have studied your testimony carefully and have seen that there is nothing there to contradict Eov. Not one of you could even answer what he had to say. Dare you assert that we have discovered wisdom, God, not man, has afflicted Eov. So Yitzchak, or let's call him Elihu for the sake of argument, comes up and he's trashing everyone. He basically says you're all heretics by the letter of the law. By the letter of law of suffering, your party line, your poor observations, and your claim that God has afflicted you and not man. Does this work, bringing it into context like this with a running start? Much different than when you try to read shit cold every time, right? Mm. And since Eov did not direct his words to me, I will not use your statements in my answer to him. There were those who retreated and could not answer any further, and there were those who were at loss for words. I therefore waited until they had ended their discussion, stood up, and answered no further. It is now my turn to respond and speak my peace. I too can reveal my ideas, for I am full of words. You're getting that 208 here. This is very much Pinchas with the spear. I mean, you can hear the fire coming through Elihu when you realize the intensity. See, when you don't rise up to the challenge, it's like, okay, my name is Elihu. Hi, boys and girls, I'm here to talk. And Eov, how you doing? Good? Okay. But when you realize Yitzchak and the nature of Eov, And you see, you know, Yitzchak taking command tends to resonate a little differently. And you can begin to fathom Pinchas with the spear when he stood up also and took command, right, of a heretical type of situation. For I am full of words. Their force has swelled my abdomen. Where else do you know about that? Right, this is the way Gilgal and Tikkun work in the Kabbalah, right, where Pinchas stabbed and speared the abdomen of the sinner. Here, Yitzchak, who Pinchas is a Gilgal of, according to the result, is swelling out of his abdomen. Where one is blood from Znus, this is the secrets of creation. That's how the result learns it a lot of times. That kind of connection. Of, you know, show how Pinchas coming from Yitzchak swells in his abdomen from Torah. Pinchas spears the abdomen of Znus. So it's a continuation. Behold, my belly is like an unopened wine cask. And also, it fits very good. You know why? They say that Noah sinned with alcohol. Yosef was drinking and held himself back from the brothers, a Gilgal on Noah. Pinchas, in front of the brothers also, where he was not drinking, they were drinking. He did not hold himself back. He went and did it. So it's kind of like one-upping each time. The Kabbalah teaches that's actually the secret of Gilgal. When you one-up, you become a Gilgal. Right? When you, if you were to, I'm making this up for context, right? You're to beat, you know, a metaphor, four kings. Right? Let's say you outdid Avraham in a theoretical world. You would actually be continuing his story through Gilgal. Whatever it is. You know, Yiftach gave his daughter to death. You took your daughter and, you know, you did some great mitzvah. You would repair it, receive it, and you continue the story. You know, then you went to the Kohen instead of not going to the Kohen. You see how it works? Continuation. I will therefore speak in order to obtain relief. I have only to part my lips to answer. He's dying to give it over. Dying to give it over. I will not favor any person or make any pretense at flattery, for I do not even know how to flatter my maker, and were I to try, he would surely remove me from this world. Now, the idea in the commentary also was the point of Eov is understanding the concept of God in flesh. Now, before you go Christian on me, right? The Christians take it in perversion, and Eov comes to negate Christianity for that reason. It's going to be in verse 37:18. I think this is the most fantastic destruction of Christianity that ever lived. But what it means is that God runs the world through his creation. And we know that God is one. So it's a contradiction. How is God one and there's creation? And that's Eov, the conundrums of philosophy. So the point is that man is flesh and blood. And as the commentary here describes, if Elihu answers Eov from pure Elikus, Eov gets intimidated. You know, if he says something like, hey, Eov, how can you proclaim that God is not good when God is with you? And all the secrets of the Merkava, which you're not even allowed to speak in front of more than one. For that reason, because people don't get it. That's how you get a cult like Christianity. Resolving such contradictions, how is God one and yet he has a creation? How am I one with God when I say Shema Yisrael, Shema Kehoz, Shema Chad? How do I exist? I'm a Russia for even existing. Because that's ego, and that says there is no God. So these are all the philosophical questions that come about. And to get into them, this is why Chagiga says in the Gemara, do not teach Maisa Merkava in front of more than, you know, X amount of people, one or two, based on Maisa Breishis and Maisa Merkava. So Elihu knows that. Yitzchak knows that. How do you resolve it? Teach it from the flesh as man. Elihu's the guy, not God. But he teaches about God to Eov, and he understands his own connection with God. So Elihu is his own kind of Eov, and he lets God inspire him in real time to give the message of God over to Eov. So Eov is not actually talking to or relating to God. He's talking to a guy. But that guy trusts God, brings down the fire of God, relates it to Eov. So it's a total paradox. Two men discussing mundane matters compared to Elikus, but they're in a godly environment. You could call it holy, godly. Elihu knows how to bring out Ruach HaKodesh. That is the ultimate conundrum. How? But doesn't matter. Because the way he did it, Eov listens to the wisdom. Right? The idea is, be a vessel. You and I are talking to each other. If God is coming through, That's none of one's business. We know it's happening, but it's not our business. We continue as men. And we may know in our mind, God is still coming through. But yet we exist. And this is going to be the essence of Eov. And I'll give it over right now. We hit the groove right now. Two guys are talking Torah. We know that God is coming through. So why is it either not a Avodah Zarah, a cult, Sheker, or whatever else? He answers the end, it's called Tzedakah. We know that God is greater than this conversation. But we know that we're experiencing godliness in this conversation. That's how you can know God's ways in this world. Is God here right now in this conversation, technically? But not encapsulated in Mamish. So we know God is above, well beyond the scope of this room. Well beyond any intellectual endeavor ever. And yet we know that he's coming through for the sake of this creation and reality. In such a microcosmic setting, it's ridiculous. It's not calculable. Or how do you say it? Calculable? That is the greatness of God. We came in this world, we suffered, but we know that God is great. Why? We can perceive the idea in the flesh that he is beyond and that he entertains his creation. Which makes sense, as you always say, right? Yitzchak means to laugh. And in the Navi, it's called Yitzchak, with a shin, a sin. Which David HaMelech says, that's the name to play. That our world is nature. But God also entertains another universe, when you call it the ether. And that world is all angelic. So as I talk right now, it's just, you know, blah, 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 blah. In an ether world, God entertains the angels. And they do perceive more of God. And the worlds mix, says David HaMelech and Tillim. And our words are actually godly. More than even prophetic. The angels themselves are attached to the words. And we don't have access to but just a smidgen. The point is, even if I don't know what I'm saying, and you don't know what you're saying, it's still being said. The message goes out. The message is still here. Now at that point, it's transcendent. You're getting more than you know. I'm getting more than I know from you. And those listening are getting what they get, and it goes out to the whole world right now. Everyone gets what they get. And the more you can fathom the greatness of God in your own personal Eov program, you reiterate this program, this fractal of God, the greatness, the message, it all goes out. It's like ripples. And this is also a major theme in Eov. When you suffer and you become an Eov program, you're designated to be one who undertakes why do good people suffer. We'll continue the commentary on that note. Since we know, what is it? Why do good people suffer? God comes to you. You're not suffering. Not just by some accident and the cruelty of heaven and earth. Elihu says, number one, if this is you, you have no Yetzer Hara. You are a strictly good person. You don't know any evil. But God puts you in a predicament where you will be surrounded by evil. And it's a test. The test is, it's like a game show. You're getting your reward. Right? You're a good person. You have no Yetzer. You got your reward. Gan Eden, it's set. And when you read the end of the book, you will understand that it's all good. God is good. The cheshbon works out. You did not get shanghaied. It was worth your while to come in this world and play this part. You perpetuated evil. You allowed evil to get punished. And you still got your good due reward. And you'll say, but how is that possible? Ah, you didn't listen. Is God above this conversation right now? But you don't know. You don't know what's up there. So two, the equation is good because we know we can fathom God's ways without knowing God's ways. Logical deduction. Like the party line they were trying to say, but didn't quite get it right. So too with the suffering soul. We know God's ways. It will work out. But I can't explain it. I can't give it over. But I can rationalize with absolute emes, it does work out. There's a giloi that it works out. But I am not above enough to go up and witness heaven and say, ah, I got it. And I'll just bring in the proof against Christianity now. What is the big story of Yashka? That he died. There's your suffering servant, and he's the EO program, right? And he goes up to heaven. He rises up. That's the story. Look at 37:18. 37:18. How do you propose to rise up with God to the uppermost reaches of heaven, which are as intense as a burnished mirror? Is that not fantastic? There's a scriptural proof. Nothing can rise up beyond this world to know what is above. Nothing. So not only does it bring down the Avodah Zarah, but you and your own little gaiva ego program that you run in your own mind, that you know why God does stuff. Right? When you give your party line, you know why. Okay, so you rose up. So Eliyahu is telling you, if you can claim that, then you can leave this world and go up on your own. No one goes up. So the Matrix, bend the spoon is impossible. Why? There is no spoon. You cannot go against this nature. And the answer is, again, Eliyahu tells you, because God makes nature happen. That Simsum allows God to hide in nature. He says that when lightning strikes, thunder blasts, that is God's voice. You'll say, that what is this, some kind of pagan ritual? He says, no. The nature in the world collaborates as creation of God. And when God makes wonders in the world, it's accompanied by a sign in the flesh. So there's a loud thunder. That's God. Whatever God's doing way up, it comes out in our world as thunder. Then he says, by the way, when there's thunder, the bandit is coming for you. He's now in motion. I pushed him in motion. The wolves are after you. Now they're going. So when you recognize the world around you as alive, as an organism, you become like Elihu. You rise up and you say, I have words. I understand the universal truth by the very right of my existence. I have the right to truth because I live. I can understand you because you live too. He says, all the judgments are open. Life happens. Life happens. So to say you're going to transcend is ridiculous. That's like saying that when you're the most thirsty, I'm not going to drink a drop. That's how righteous I am. That's stupid. If you're thirsty, drink. So when God gives you the moment of ultra spirituality, knowing God's ways, it's in your only interest to stay in this world and go through it and deal with it. To escape is to die. That's when God kills you. That's when Mashiach and Yosef dies. That's when the suffering soul contemplating suicide will make his dumb move. You'll start to enact your suicide. Well, you know, take it. Go ahead. Take all my money. Go ahead. Dumb move. You gave in to anger. You threw it all away. Now you're one step closer to death. You gave God a reason to kill you. He wanted you to have the money for, you know, to give tzedakah, whatever it is. And you threw it away because you were angry. Bye. Bye-bye. Shep and Yosef dies. You wanted to go up. Now you're going to go up. Now you really will die. And when you get to Shemayim, just like Yev ends, you got to see how what happens with God. But you didn't get to see how God's ways are in this world. And that's the ikker. So when the lightning strikes and this and that and your life is horrible, that's when life is working at its highest. Because you can perceive God in this world and the next. On a bit of a, you know, you can perceive above, you perceive here, you see, you got it. So what happened to Eov? He said, when I'm feeling great, I love it. Yeah, everyone's awesome. When Eov is taken into suffering, not because he's a Rasha, he's been chosen. When he's low, he says, you know, when he sees the Rishoyim, he says, kill them all. Bring the big hurricane to the islands and wipe them out. They don't know that Hashem is God and the Mashiach is close, like all the blogs on the internet. Leah says, and God says, when you were feeling good, you didn't do that. You were making garum, and you were good. When you got low, you got bitter and said, kill the Rishoyim. Now I've got to take more stuff away. Because you weren't righteous. You were only bitter because of the predicament you were in. When you're pampered, you behave. When you're miserable, you act like a behemoth. So that's the story. You have to have the good attitude when you're low. What does David HaMelech say to Tehillim over and over and over again? I was brought low and God, you know, brought me up. God saved me. Start to get a picture of Eov now. It's your, in your best interest to go through with this world. Don't just sell out. Because it's a nice thing to say, oh, kill them all. We're showing anti-Semites. And it's a party line. Judaism loves to do that. Hitler, kill him. All the people, kill him, kill him, kill him. But David HaMelech said Amalekites can also become Bnei Noach. So yes, we have a mitzvah to kill a Amalek. Yes, we hate our enemies. Yes, we do the grogger on Haman. But when you start to say your ethnocentric isms, that's only about me and my people, and when I'm low, kill them all. That's when God says no. That's not the creation. You're asking me, God, he says, to kill my creation, to kill my ways. That's heresy. You say, what, you want the Rishayim to live? Hitler's a good guy to live. So then you say, okay, Meisim Merkava, you're learning, you can't handle it. So when you oscillate between God's ways, and then you enclose it in this world, now you're back to this world again, and we can talk about a different subject within Eov. Until the point when you can fathom God's ways. And then, there's no explaining it. There is no explanation of how the Rishoyim can live.
We're saying the Aleinu. Lahafnos Alecha Kol Rishayoret.
Right.
Every prayer, bring back the Rishoyim to you.
That's
all
it.
All the earth.
It's a contradiction. That's Eov. When you're there, you're there. When you're not, you're not. Until you're there. Until you can proclaim God's greatness and His ways. And how do you do it? You say, well, let me prepare a little longer. Look at Eliyahu. He said, no. I'm going to proclaim God's greatness by just jumping in and doing it. What does Eov do? He starts having a revelation from God. He starts telling you all about God. Now's a better time than ever. Elihu made Eov realize that now that he's low, it's about being with a good attitude of God and his creation. Don't give in to sin just because you're low. Go through it. Don't give evil its early demise just because you're miserable. Remain righteous. Abraham prayed. Avraham Avinu prayed for Sodom. 10 men. He passed the test. Everyone knows Avraham passed the test. And where did Elihu learn it from? Yitzchak ben Avraham. So you see how why Avodah Zarah is so ridiculous. To say they go up, that they rose from the dead, is counterproductive on every level. Even as a fairy tale, it's a stupid fairy tale. You know, George Carlin has a joke in nicer words. He says, I'm going to be the first guy to say, I can't wait to shove this pen in my ear and punch out my eardrum. No one's ever said that. Because no, it's a stupid thing to say. There's no reason to say it. So to say that someone went up to heaven is ridiculous. Moshe Rabbeinu Shemayim in the Torah is not the same level. You know, receiving the Torah instruction is a different deal. We're talking about going to God Himself. God Himself. There's no such thing. Not even as a desire. You should, it's wrong. It's wrong to even desire it. You know, it's like people say, I want Mashiach now. I don't care how, just now. That's dumb. There's a way of Mashiach. Mashiach and Yosef, the Gula, Eliyahu. Don't just say you want Mashiach and David now. That means you haven't learned it. You don't even know what you're talking about. So to say, I want to go with God. You don't know what you're talking about. No man will see my face and live. That's not a challenge like, let's see if you can. It's reality. Be in this world. This is where you see God's ways. And you can entertain the whole story. When you die, you will be brought up. And you'll say, but you just said I can't go up. By the time you die, you've made your keli into something suitable. Right? Rabbi Akiva, his whole thing, until he said Shema, under those terms, he wasn't ready to go up. Again, then you say, you know, the Holocaust, that had to happen for a certain reason. Make the keli, you can get the revelation. Why do righteous people suffer? Why do good people suffer? The cheshbon works, but you can't articulate it. But when you die, you will be ready for death. You will have your moment. Eov had his moment at the end. He got everything because God is good, and you have to say, if God is good, you do get everything. But if you say as a party line, I want to be with God, that's party line. You took it out of context, and that's heretical. So it's a very fine line between life and death anyways. You know what I'm saying? But by the time you really do die, you became a vessel worthy of the revelation that you're going to get when you go up. Now the point is also, when Eov was, you know, brought to this place of suffering, and he was a good soul, no Yitzhar Hara, blah blah blah, the story continues that God suppresses the evil that's buried deep within. And he makes you suffer. And you say, well, how is it possible that I will be able to have the scales balance out? And the answer is, when you're sleeping, he says, God will put a vision in you. Right? When you are the Eov program, the truth enters you with like a vision. Your ears are opened up. The Tardema comes to you. We say by Adam, a deep sleep came over him, right? By Abraham, a deep sleep came over him, right? You also will have had a deep sleep. The dream that you wake up from and say, what was that? Where it has a clarity. Not just like, well, I made a go-kart with my landlord, then I had some popcorn, my teeth fell out, and I woke up and I was freaked out. Not that. When you wake up and you say, whoa! I was in Shemayim and Michael, the angel, and there's a harp. And then God, you know, sent an angel to me and it said, go to Friendly's on Thursday. And you're like, what? What is that? Right, so that is a vision from Tardema. Because it's consistent. It was like, it was something. It was something. And that's when your ears are opened. And your psyche is opened. And you have access to the natural, innate, universal Torah of your soul. That you can relate to everybody else. And now the test begins. Now the Moser Nefesh begins. How far will you take that truth? That's the question. And this is, by the way, a subtopic. Eov is the book of Mazel. It says you have a Malach Melitz Echad. That until you're down to your last angel, then God will save you and vindicate you, bring you your Mazel back, bring you your life back, change your Mazel, no more suffering, Eov. We're not talking savior salvation like the cult. We're saying you went through the fire. You did your Avraham Avinu test. You went through it. You vanquished evil without having to say, kill them all. You sanctified God's name. Now, like Eov at the end of the book, you have your shalva. You have peace. You get your stuff back. You get your soul back. You get on your feet. You hit rock bottom. Now you keep going. The more earthy it becomes, the more livable it gets. But the reason why it's Mazel is because Mazel in the Talmud, Baba Kama, and Shabbos actually, calls your Mazel a Melitz, an angel that's kind of with you. And before you daven, it says the angel actually requests from God before you do for your Mazel. You have an angel of Mazel. Kind of giving a status update on you to God, a cheshbon.
Where is that Malach Echad?
It's a pasuk in Eov. I didn't write down the verse. Did not write down the verse, but it's a verse in Eov. Look for it. The lashon is Yesh Malach Melitz Echad. If you look in the concordance, you have for the word Melitz, and you'll see how it comes up in Eov. And this is the idea of Mazel, right? So the idea is that in the Mazel discussion, everyone's, the first thing you're going to say, again, perfect Eov, right? Oh, no Mazel for Israel. You just did a party line, thank you very much. That is not the question of the Talmud, not in the slightest. The question is, since you have Mazel of a Jewish flavor up on high, not the consolations, can you change it? If I'm the guy that stumbles every whatever, can I change that? I always get the short end of the deal. Can I change that? Yes. Tefillah, through Moser Nefesh, through Schus. What's the Schus? Beating the Eov program. Don't give in to the Eov program. Don't just say, since life is horrible, I have a Hector to be a Russia. Even though I'm not really a Russia, you don't have the Hector. When you go through the program, like King David says, like David Melch says, just go through the program. Then, what does it say? One second. That, I wrote this down with David Melch. Is that a put one soon? Okay. When you go through the program and your head is filled with how great God is, that's how you get rid of the Eov program. And it's not getting rid of it. That's already a derogatory way also. View it as an opportunity. You know how like in video games, it's like you play the regular game and they have like a bonus round. Eov is a bonus round. It suits God's purposes. You're lucky because you have earned it because you are a good person. No Yetzer. No inherent evil. But the test is, when you are brought low, will you behave like a Russia? And you're being used to pay out the Rishoyim to die early. All of God's Chishboinus are on you. This is what David HaMelech was after. And he succeeded. Moshe succeeded. David succeeded, Yitzchak succeeded, Pinchas succeeded. If I'm not mistaken, this seems to be the Mashiach's consciousness. Shem, Noah, all of our friends, all of the great Kruvim type souls of Atzilus, Avraham. This is the program. When you go through Eov, you change your Mazel. That is the schus that we're talking about in the schus equation. That is the tefillah from your mazel that we're talking about. And now we understand when Shlomo got the dream of Chachma, why Shlomo and Mishlei say, open your ear, go out with wisdom, tell the wisdom, and then listen as it comes back. That's the program. Mashiach ben David, Shlomo ben David. Gematria Emes, by the way. Shlomo tells you to do it. When you're in the EOF program, when you're in the Mashiach program, all you really have to do is listen. God will give you and open the wisdom of your soul, of your psyche, and that knot in your head, for you to understand how God is not cruel, not unfair, and not come to her heresy, not try to leave this world before your time in an idolatrous way, and have the wisdom to go out, having conquered it, realize God's ways from the charity he gives you, and say, hey buddy, Eov, let me tell you how to get out of the Eov program. The guy who survives Eov tells the next guy how to get out of Eov. Yitzchak helps the true Eov. When you go through Eov, the suicide program, and you conquer it without giving in to that temptation of the ultimate evil that nourishes all evil, you conquer it. Why do righteous people suffer? It's the ultimate bonus round. The cheshbon is good. You are paid for your deeds. You are not inherently evil. All the great works are on this point. David HaMelech and Tehillim, Moshe Rabbeinu and Hazinu. What's Hazinu? Give ear. What does Eliyahu say? Listen. You need to listen to this. You're not going to get it when you don't listen. That's Eov. When you go in Stam, you don't get it. When you listen and say, I'm listening to every word, then you're getting it. He says, Eov, listen, I'm not going to beat you up. This is not going to be a painful Yaakov and the Malach wrestling match. But we think that we approach Eov, we're going to beat up. We've already been beat up enough. You're not going to get beat up. This is the message. You go through Eov to get the message and give the message. When Eov wakes up to God, consciousness, he's got the message. So what does he do? When God comes to Eov, let me tell you about the Leviasa. Let me tell you about the Shorabar. Is there anything more fantastic than Leviasa? Imagine if a guy says, hey, listen, let me tell you about the Leviasa. If you meet somebody telling you about the Leviasa, you better assume he knows God pretty well for what it's worth in this world. So that's what Eov was doing. He got low, he did tshuva, he stopped cursing, and before he got paid back, he's still low, his attitude changed, and he says, let me tell you about the Leviathan. He's got that God consciousness. He's flesh and blood. But he lets God channel through him. And he's aware of it. He's aware that I'm here, God is in this world, showing his ways, he's well above. He's dropped the heresy. He's got, really, the nekudas of Kabbalah in Simsum in the palm of his hand. And he's not wishing to see the face of God, which everybody would think that's the real Kabbalah. See the face of God. No! And so what do you do when you're there? You talk about how great God is in his ways. So now Eo's telling Eliyahu, let me tell you how great God is. And what does he do? He jumps right in. He just tells it as he's going. And says, I don't even know what the message is. I'm just saying it. I know it. Can't articulate it, but I'm just going to do it. That's how you do it. You just do it. That's how you engage with God. You confront life. You just do it. And the message goes out. Because if you start talking Simsum and Kabbalah and Av and Sog and Ma and Bon, that's already Maisa Merkava. Now you're trying to get to the face of God. Now you're the Rasha you proclaim that you're not. Now you might have to die. You bring offense to yourself. And Mashiach is the Gematria Nachash. But if you persist in righteousness and just live as flesh and blood, it's okay to live in this world. It's okay to not be perfect. It's okay to be an emistic human being. Don't judge on how great you look and sound. God is looking for your heart and the real wisdom. Musser, change your ways. What's the biggest change of ways from, let me tell you how great I am, to let me tell you how great God is? If you're telling how great you are, there's a problem. When all you can do is tell how great God is, and you sound like a schoolboy, you're doing something right. Because that means you came to the EO program. If you came to the program, it means you didn't give in to Rishus. It means the whole world's doing in Seder. The thunder of God is going out. The message is going out. You're bringing a lukus into the world. Sweetening all the gevuras. Now the biggest problem people have in their das, why does God do it? You always bring this up. You always ask me, does Hashem have a korban of a human being? We see that Michael in the third temple, in the heavenly temple, they offer the neshamas and tzaddikim above. We say, wow, that's weird. Again, pagan kind of, right? But it's not. Point is, there is death, and God does take souls. People die. And I think everyone but like two people on record have died. That's one of the challenges. If God wanted to kill everybody, could he? Yeah. If God wanted to make everyone righteous all of a sudden, could he? Yeah. God is God. But being that God does design that some people are just meant to die, the chiddush is, it's not without a cheshbin that God is good. And the party line will say, ah, but since he died the way he did, he must be a Russia. That's party line. But he did die in Russia. And God will say he did. Because you were Eov and you were expected to not die. The fact that you died in Russia. You don't get a Jewish burial. But since God knows the cheshbin, you only died because you were placed in the Eov program. And you didn't get a Jewish burial to show an eternal simon. The evil people get punished. God is a true judge. If you didn't get punished by the way you died, wicked people would look and say, who cares? So it's on high where they have the last laugh. Yitzchak, Yitzchak. Down here we moan and groan and complain. Suicide and the death and the klippas and the rishoyim. How can it be? Point fingers and blame. It's all a message. How do you decode the message? Know how great God is. Which again, how do you get there? Go through the Eov program. Mashiach ben Yosef dies, but what does the Gra say? Od Yosef Chai. Has to go through the Gezera of death to show that he lives in the end. Again, the idea is the world is pulsating this called nature. God, his hands in creation, pulsating it. Waiting for people to stand up and sanctify God in this unique way. David HaMelech, in one of his psalms, says very clearly, when you come to a truth of God, all there is proclaiming how great God is. That's what Eov is about. And don't wait for the nature to pulsate with a thunderstorm that'll make you stand up. Realize you don't need God to make a thunderstorm to wow you. That's only a sideshow. Is it not miraculous now? Is right now not an incredible moment in history? So stand up right now and proclaim God is great. You don't need the thunderstorm in the end. That's the chiddush. You'll say, wait, we need a sign of Mashiach. You're right back to killing Rishayim again. When you say you want a sign, what are you really saying? You want the thunder to scare the death out of somebody. No! Just live. Stand up now. And what he does is Elihu shows how to bring down the revelation of God. Just go there. Say, I am flesh and blood. And I don't know how God interacts with the creation really. But I know that in my mind, through the tzedakah of God, I can fathom there's a concept of God well beyond God working the Bria. And when I just go and talk and say, you get the message because God pushes it through. All I have to do is know that and do it. And then, no matter how low I get, keep going. And that's how the Rishonim get the message, not by killing them. Then someone gets the message and stands up and says, hey, I get it. We'll close with this. Just as Eov lives by Elihu finding the wisdom, sacred wisdom of life, by the precious chosen ways of God, we can say Mashiach ben Yosef will live by the Pasuk itself, Od Yosef Chai. Yosef still lives. And with that, we have concluded the suffering series, Kabbalah the Narcissist. And all the evils and suffering and propagandas and conspiracies in the horrible world. Why? Because just like Elihu's name is the Gematria Mashiach, this is Yitzchak, the father of Israel, according to the Talmud. The one that we can relate to. And Pinchas, the spear, the whole point. Everybody goes through their Eov moment. Everyone knows that one person either did suicide, thought suicide, right? You went through your crucial moment where you pondered whether that or close to it, or whatever it is, whatever mishigas you do. Eov is here to say, you can put your mishigas in this arena. And when you do, all you do is follow Eov, follow it through, let the revelation come in the text. And that's the path revelation comes to you. That's called recognizing God is great. Be you. Don't escape. Let the revelation come. Give the message. That's the wisdom that God put in you when you were chosen to suffer, because you're actually not that bad. Don't beat yourself up. And realize the righteous ways of God.